starters, but Newcastle could so easily have written a less dramatic story. New skipper Kevin Dillon pinched the ball off Mark McGee's toes, but the crossbar spoiled his scoring debut. But the new boys were soon causing trouble. A sweeping pass from McGee sends John Gallagher away, and the first sight of his real pace was enough to panic Jim Beglin. Every inch a penalty. Now look for Mick Quinn's cheeky sudden turn as he plants the ball wide of Mervyn Day with total confidence. One up after 18 minutes. But only 3 minutes later, keeper Tommy Wright presented Gordon Strachan with the ball. It's out wide to John Hendry back against his old team, and Bobby Davison follows in for the equaliser. A needless goal to give away. Then another former black and white, Peter Haddock, launches a free kick towards Hendry, and Ian Baird nips in as Wright is left stranded off his line. Straight after half-time, it was Quinn to the rescue, bending down with a boots fly to hold United back on level terms. But Mighty Mick was just getting into his stride. So too was Gallagher, who had an outstanding debut. He sets up the chance, and Newcastle's number nine is there to bundle in his hat-trick. And United weren't finished yet. Mind you, Newcastle still needed a bit of help at the other end, where not all was right at the back. Tommy Wright was busily making amends for earlier mistakes. But no worries, 5 minutes from time, Gallagher decided to grab his own share of the glory, setting off for a superb solo goal that on any other day would have stolen the headlines. But Mick Quinn was determined to hog the back pages. 2 minutes from time, he's away on his own, and nothing was going to keep him from number four. An incredible result, and not the sort of game you'd really want to boycott.
The class of Gordon Strachan shone through after Leeds went one down at Stoke. A golden moment from United skipper. It was always going to be tight at Hull, so it proved. Just 2 minutes gone when Gordon Strachan served up the winner for Leeds. Bobby Davison got the decisive touch.
Vinny's on target for Leeds. At Upton Park, and Leeds got the perfect start against West Ham. Mike Whitlow's cross, and who said Vinny Jones wasn't a touch player? A sublime finish from a player who certainly knows how to celebrate. West Ham play some pretty football though, and Kevin Keane almost stole an equaliser. Fine tackle by Chris Fairclough. Julian Dix with a little chip over the top created the next opening for Mark Ward. Mervyn Day did enough to put him off. George Parrish somehow found some space through the middle, and again Day stretching to make Lou Macari unhappy. The Leeds fans very happy. West Ham 0, Leeds 1.
In so many ways, this is the match of the season for Bradford City and Leeds United. Always desperately keen to win the derby, and a poignant occasion for Mark Hazlewood, Leeds United's captain last season until he was suspended and stripped of the captaincy. Today he faces his old club and Vinnie Jones as the new captain of Bradford City. Jimmy Quinn, and behind him is Paul Jewell. Will get the cross in too, and a good chance here for Bradford in the very first minute, and Fairclough has to turn it away. It went beyond Mervyn Day, and Leeds were in trouble at the back then. Tinian, another good cross, and Mervyn Day will keep the ball in play, and the referee chooses to ignore his linesman as well. And with the aid of the wind, a huge kick and a header. Oh, and it scraped past the upright there, and it was a corner. Jones and Baird were both going for it, and that all came from Mervyn Day's huge punt upfield. So the first corner of the match is Leeds United's. A lively beginning. Here is Strachan. Baird has made a forceful run. Jones is underneath it. Away by Adcock, whose prime responsibility is to score goals. Davidson, the flick on for Fairclough. Just away by Jackson. Useful, and Tomlinson in trouble. Davison stretches, knocked away by Abbott. Now Bradford break. What a beginning to the match. Now Batty is searching ball towards Baird. As expected, the ball is in the air a great deal. Oh, it's a lovely touch inside for Davison, who's brought down by Hazelwood. So although Jones puts the shot in, the free kick had been awarded. Jones asking why advantage wasn't played. It's still a good position for Leeds to have the free kick. Well, Sterling's had one crack at goal from a similar position. Strachan is captain, orchestrating it and chipping it as well. Good effort. Tomlinson flicking it over the top with the fingertips. But a really good effort from the Scottish international. He's never played at Valley Parade before. It's the first time he's ever played against Bradford City, in fact, and he almost celebrated it with a goal. Batty busy as ever. Haddock. Whitlow's cantering up the left, gets it now. Turns it back for Strachan. And that was Williams coming in on it. Davison's there and Shawan pushed. Davison appeared to be pushed. Vinnie Jones will complain to referee Breen. Although Davison himself seems unperturbed. The decision was no penalty. Batty chased by Adcock, still Batty, a good ball through for Baird as well. Davison is in the middle and Ian Baird chooses to slice it right across the face of goal. It's going to go out for a throw-in, in fact. A strong Leeds United influence here at Valley Parade, of course. Norman Hunter in the middle, Terry Yorath next to him. Great names from Leeds United's past. And Brian Edwards on Terry Yorath's left as well, was on the Leeds staff at one time. Batty, and a lot of Leeds players up now. Davison just checks. Vinnie Jones, Baird in here, Ian Baird. Oh, and it wriggles agonisingly past the upright. The closest that Leeds have come. And Ian Baird has not had the best of luck in terms of goal scoring this season. He's unlucky again. The ball was held up there. Jones pinged the pass across. Baird taking it on, got the shot in. Tomlinson had it covered, to be fair to him. But no doubt they've been working on this. It's out by Whitlow to Batty. Batty, now a real charge on towards the Bradford goal, and Leeds airing forward. They've got three men. Williams is on the ball. Here's Davison inside the penalty area, and he's going to put it too far. It's gone behind. It's a corner kick. And I think that Bradford really felt that that should have been a goal kick. There's real danger there for Bradford. Strachan. Tomlinson wasn't sure, and Sterling's header fizzes over the top of the bar. Tomlinson set off and changed his mind. Strachan's corners always present danger, but watch Tomlinson. He sets off, then goes back, and Sterling's header is just too high. And again, Leeds might just be caught square as Campbell takes on the fullback Whitlow, who's recovered his composure. The ball is turned back for Mitchell. Swinging cross from Mitchell, and a fierce header. Good one, too. And almost a dream goal for Mark Hazelwood. He rose at the perfect moment. It was almost a copybook goal, this. Hazelwood's header against his old club, and Mervyn Day, a brilliant save. Campbell days up again, clutches it handily. What a great save that was from Mervyn Day. Close to 600 league games and as good as ever. Howard Wilkinson invariably starts the match watching from the stands and then comes down to ground level. That's exactly what he's done today. Campbell Campbell's seen a lot more of the ball in the second half, and he's won a corner for his club. Mitchell wanted it short, but Campbell, I think, will drive it into the heart of the penalty area. Quinn's coming for it. Ooh, the goalkeeper flaps, and it's away off the line by Haddock. Not very far, though, and Hazelwood gets too much height on his shot. Rather glum expression from Mervyn Day. He won't have enjoyed that. So he might well have been looking at the referee. Adcock's challenge seemed to just put him off momentarily. He's won an awful lot in the air. Oh, good run by Williams here, and he's got support, and Vinnie Jones inside the area. Oh, Vinnie Jones, a screamer. It ripped back that left upright. Beautiful ball played through by Andy Williams as well. Andy Williams, a really good probing run here. He sees Jones setting off, finds him with a delightful pass and a first-time shot, but whizzed past that upright. Well, Leeds have had a vice-like grip in midfield, but not been able to conjure up a goal. Sterling might be the man. Goes trying to get on the end of Strachan. Davieson! Oh, what a chance wasted. And he knows. He really does know that that's the best chance that might be coming his way this afternoon. Sterling's forceful run, but then watch for the little ricochet. Strachan, and then the ball clatters into Sterling's chest, actually. Came fortunately to Davieson. Batty, and Leeds have plenty of men up, and Davieson is here, and Davieson scores for Leeds. What a glorious cross it was as well. Davieson perfectly positioned to pounce. It's in the back of the Bradford net. The Leeds fans are ecstatic. And Bradford really punished here by the precision of David Batty's cross, the timing of Davieson's jump. Tomlinson beaten all ends up. And thumbs up for Davidson, thumbs up for Leeds United. They're in the lead. That's four in four games for Bobby Davieson now, eight this season. And he really is a striker in form. Here come Bradford, though, with Adcock and Campbell. Now Quinn, Jewell, Hazelwood, through for Adcock, oh, he's driven it wide of the upright, and it's the best that Bradford have had. It's a lovely move involving about five players. You always felt that Leeds were looking for an offside somehow, and when that wasn't awarded, Hazelwood here, and then Mitchell, and now Adcock, agonisingly wide. So for the second week running, a Bobby Davieson goal wins Leeds United 3 points, and for Bradford it's 3-1-0 defeats in the last four games now. So valuable points here for Leeds in front of their fans at Valley Parade.
Played at Leicester so all their fans could get in, and a good job too. 7 minutes gone, Sterling's long ball, Ian Baird. His second goal in successive matches, and Leicester's prospects of adding to their season's total of two wins not looking good. Especially with Leeds' second goal after 25 minutes. Again the long ball, but there's nothing wrong with a long ball game when it's played as well as this. Strachan's ball, Andy Williams on the end of it. And how's that for a way to take your first goal of the season? In the second half, the floodlights on. Leicester manager David Cleat brought on substitute Paul Ramsey. It worked. Here he is. And 10 minutes later, with 65 minutes gone, Leicester were level. Leeds failing to clear properly. Gary McAllister on the left with too much skill for Andy Williams. The cross headed away by Mike Whitlow, not very far. And that was Ramsey again. 2-2. Leeds' third goal again came from the long ball, played by Williams this time. Davieson brought down by Steve Walsh. Mr. Moole says a penalty. And have you ever seen a penalty taken like this before? How would he have felt if he'd missed it? Still, the action wasn't over. 6 minutes to go. and Leicester came back in the game. Again, that was Ramsey involved, spreading the ball out wide to the left. McAllister's cross. Paul Moran at the far post, getting there before Whitlow and Haddock. Leicester, remember, with only two wins all season. They made it three. The cross not cleared by Mervyn Day. And the grateful acceptance of the chance by Gary McAllister, with 5 minutes left, putting Leicester 4-3 in front. And there was worse news still for Leeds, because Mervyn Day had been injured in that clash, and he sadly was carried off with a suspected dislocated shoulder. Leicester 4, Leeds 3.
Start at West Brom with just 8 minutes gone. Kevin Bartlett unsettles the defence, and the finish from ex-Bradford striker Don Goodman. Too good for Chris Turner. Goal number 10 for Goodman this season. Then a minute before half-time, West Brom second. Tony Ford figures in the move, and this time it's Goodman returning the compliment with a header, enabling Bartlett to force it in. Howard Wilkinson's half-time roasting did have some effect. Car shut on for Vinnie Jones rattled the bar, but neither Gordon Strachan nor Bobby Davison could find a way through. It looked like being a fruitless afternoon, until Strachan's free kick sparked a messy scramble. Mike Whitlow heads on, Bobby Davison tucks it on a bit further, and Chris Fairclough forces home his sixth goal of the season. It wasn't enough, though. It ended West Brom 2, Leeds 1.
Hello and welcome to our soccer special. Once upon a time, they called Middlesbrough against Leeds a Yorkshire derby. But today's second division battle has far wider significance. In fact, the whole of the North East will be watching, because this result could give a major boost to both Newcastle and Sunderland's promotion drive. Middlesbrough are trying desperately hard to catch up with their great neighbours and rivals, who are both tucked in behind the Borough's opponents today. Bruce Rioch's team started their campaign to return to Division One in really disappointing style. But there's a feeling now that the old rhythm is returning, even though they lost at Wolves last week. Gary Parkinson returns to the defence in place of the suspended Nicky Moen, and Trevor Putney is fit again in midfield, so Mark Brennan is on the bench. Leeds manager Howard Wilkinson springs a major surprise. His two principal strikers, Ian Baird and Bobby Davison, are both injured, so John Pearson and Carl Schutt will spearhead the attack. But one of Leeds' most expensive signings, Mel Stirland, has recovered from the bruised ribs he collected in the one-goal win against Newcastle. Noel Blake stays in the back four, even though the former United defender Peter Haddock is back after a calf injury, which kept him out of the game against his old club. It's by far and away the most expensive lineup in the division, brimful of experience. Today's referee, David Scott from Burnley.
So it's second place Leeds United who get us underway. 20 points the difference between these two teams. Middlesbrough down in 18th position, but Leeds, of course, with a reshuffled attack today. And it's been their 4-1 Ellen Road which has really been the foundation for their promotion drive. 8 wins in a row on their own territory, but away from Ellen Road it has been a somewhat different story. They've won 3 and drawn 3 out of 9, and in fact Ayresome Park here has been something of a graveyard. They've not won on Teesside in the last 12 visits, and you'd have to go back to 1975 when Leeds were in the European Cup final when they last got a victory here. And certainly Middlesbrough will need to pull out another excellent performance this afternoon if they are indeed to keep their movement up the table going. Gary Parkinson it is here, who's got a long throw and hurls it in towards Ripley, and that's a corner kick to Middlesbrough right in the opening seconds. Mark Proctor used to be with Leeds manager Howard Wilkinson when he was in charge at Sheffield Wednesday, and now providing the experience in Middlesbrough's midfield. And the pressure is still on Leeds. Another corner kick conceded. Proctor again to take it, and Mowbray, the number four, was looking for it. Ripley got a flick on. Slaven hoped it would come through, but it wouldn't. Shut can only find Ripley, and it's a third corner. Strong start this by Middlesbrough, who've only won 4 out of 9 at home in the league, and when they beat Oxford by a single goal a fortnight ago, it was their first home win in 6. Ripley not quite getting the knock on then. Touch there, Putney.
Aubrey still up there. Slaven, the whistle had gone. There had been a suspicion of hands when the ball came in, but the danger there clear for Leeds United. Bernie Slaven, the Borough's leading scorer by a street. A good ball played in by Proctor again. Mowbray was up there, and you can see the appeal for hands there. Fairclough turning. Pearson, Batty, looking for Shutt through the middle. Parkinson had seen it, but Shutt still carrying on. And Shutt scores. He carried on all the way and got his reward. 9 minutes gone. And Middlesbrough had their warnings earlier about hesitation in the defence. It was clipped through. There were defenders there. Parkinson must have thought he had it under control, but Shutt never gave up. And that's 1-0 to Leeds. So Carl Shutt comes in and gets his reward with the goal. 10 minutes gone now. Middlesbrough 0, Leeds United 1. Leeds will be delighted with that one, but Middlesbrough surely will be asking questions along that back four. They threw a couple of awful goals away down at Ellen Road in August, and they're certainly intent on going along a similar route this afternoon, it seems. Side called there, and Carl Shutt proving once again that you should never give up, and there's no such thing as a lost cause to chase. And he gets his first goal of the season. It was Petty who chipped it through. Mowbray left it for Parkinson, and Shutt just got the foot and Paul couldn't keep it away. Dan Gorton robbed by Fairclough. Coleman now, heading all the way. Coleman upended by Blake. And Jones protests the innocence of his colleague. Coleman looks behind him ruefully. And referee David Scott will certainly decide that is a booking for Blake. Proctor. Curl on it, all right, but just a foot or so above Mervyn Day's crossbar. The referee holding up play now, because there seem to be problems here in the corner at Ayerson Park. And some people obviously hurt there. One mum there with her two kids, another fan away on a stretcher. Seems to mainly have been young children who've been affected there, with mums and dads come up for the trip, a lot of them being led away there. The impression we get, and I must emphasise it is only an impression, no official statements have been issued obviously so far, is that some of the youngsters at the front of that enclosure were crushed against the front fences as fans from the back tried to push forward and get a better view. Sterling on the run, that's a good turn from Shutt. Strachan's in the middle, but Coleman had closed him down all the way. Very straight faces there on the Middlesbrough bench. Really has been quite an unhappy afternoon for the Borough so far, on and sadly off the pitch. In again, and again off the line, but it's gone in, and it's Fairclough, and that's 2-0 to Leeds. Middlesbrough had the men on the line, but they couldn't do anything about it this time. The corner knocked in by Strachan, the height was crucial, Middlesbrough couldn't get it away. It was a terrific leap by Fairclough, and Ripley on the line couldn't keep it out.
2-0 now to Leeds. And all sorts of problems for the Borough. Is Riak. And with more than his share of problems. And he really has got to say something fairly special during the half-time interval if he's going to inspire his Middlesbrough team. Now Slaven, he's a man who can do something. Davenport couldn't find him then, but he's got a second chance. Davenport trying to get away from Batty, but good covering by the England B midfield player. 21 last Saturday, and a man with a lot of future. Proctor, though, with this corner kick. Knocked in towards the near post. Borough can't make something of it. Inventive work there by Kernahan. Proctor again can cross. Another bad effort. Slaven wanted to get there. Blake was first. Williams. And there goes the half-time whistle. A long first half, of course, marred by those problems in the crowd. But it sees Leeds United 2 goals ahead with an injury there right at the end of the first 45 minutes. Carl Schutt setting Leeds on their way after 10 minutes, and then towards the end of that half, Chris Fairclough making it Middlesbrough 0, Leeds 2 at half-time. Welcome back to Ayresome Park for the second half. It's Middlesbrough 0, Leeds United 2. Carl Schutt and Chris Fairclough, remember, the two goal scorers in what has been a very, very eventful afternoon, with the problems among the Leeds fans who have in fact now been repositioned over the far right-hand corner of the ground. But it's Middlesbrough who've got the free kick right at the start of this second half, and they really do need to get an early goal to get back at Leeds. They've only won 3 times away from home, remember, and each time by a 1-0 margin. And Cooper may well try one. He's certainly got the power, but gone underneath it rather, and it was always on the up. Middlesbrough, who may well have their work cut out beating Mervyn Day. They've only got 3 goals in the last 5 league games. Cooper, it was from this free kick, who was trying to increase Borough's recent goal tally. Teed up, winding up for the big one, but far too high. Well, good knockout there for Davenport. Tries to take on Sterland, which is a fair job in itself, but he's not doing it badly. He did well to get the cross in. And Slaven! And Slaven, I suspect, will be disappointed at that one. Certainly by his high standards, he applauds the work done by Davenport in providing the opportunity. He wriggled away from Sterland impressively. Excellent cross, Slaven there, but he got his angles wrong on that occasion. And that, by Bernie Slaven's high standards, was a definite chance. And now Davenport. Good move, this building up now by Middlesbrough, if they can play the ball in. And Slaven looks as though he could. And through the middle there is Putney. And Day did remarkably well to keep that one out. It was a good, dangerous move by Middlesbrough from beginning to end. And Putney had read it all correctly. Slaven chips the ball in. An excellent knockback there for Putney, who got it on target, but Day grabbed it at second and third attempts. Substitute coming on. Alan Kernahan it is who's going off. And to be replaced by Mark Brennan. Leeds, who've gone 15 games unbeaten until they lost
at Leicester in early November. And it's only been their away form that spoiled them getting another record like that. And Ripley now for Middlesbrough, trying to get his team back in the game. It was excellent work by Putney. And finally there by Parkinson. And it was an awkward moment there for Mervyn Day. Harry Parkinson moving forward with some purpose and unleashing a good drive here. Had some swerve on it, and Day didn't quite collect it as cleanly as he might have liked. Middlesbrough 0, Leeds United 2. And well in control. Cleanly, but he certainly did more than enough to keep Middlesbrough at bay there. Middlesbrough still pushing forward diligently. Proctor, that's a good ball for Slaven. Coleman has stayed there in the middle. Ripley arriving too. Here goes Slaven. And just going away from Mervyn Day's left-hand post. But Slaven once again showing how quickly he can get his shots in. One of the few occasions he's had any room to run at the defence, he sidestepped his man neatly, sized up the opportunity, and it was just drifting away. But still Leeds come forward through Vinnie Jones, and Williams has skipped around Parkinson, but still has to beat his man to get the cross in, and he does now. And it's no goal offside given. Or ever shot had it in the back of the net, and he's going to fall to smile with one goal already to his credit. Excellent build up though. Jones jumping, and the foul on Proctor. Everyone from Middlesbrough has pushed forward, barring Kevin Poole, of course, and Parkinson, who will take this free kick in stoppage time. And there goes the final whistle, and Leeds take another positive step towards the First Division. A much-needed away win for Howard Wilkinson's team. A disappointing afternoon, though, for Middlesbrough. They'll be saddened at those problems with Leeds supporters being crushed, it seemed, a little midway through the first half. But after Carl Schutt gave Leeds the lead after 10 minutes through some defensive hesitation, it was downhill all the way for the Borough. Chris Fairclough made it 2-0 just before half-time, and they take the applause of the couple of thousand travelling Leeds supporters, and those who've been watching this game back at Elland Road on the big screen will be more than pleased with the afternoon's work by the Leeds United team. The final score here at Ayresome Park, it's Middlesbrough 0, Leeds United 2.
Where Sheffield United, in second place in Division 2, took on the league leaders Leeds United. Our reporter at the game was Ian McBride.
It seemed that all roads led to Bramall Lane for Yorkshire's game of the year, and kick-off was delayed 15 minutes to allow everyone to get in. Last-minute repairs to the COP satisfied council safety engineers, but South Yorkshire Fire Service caused a few hearts to flutter when they went into action. A faulty sign, though, the cause of the palpitations. And there were just as many nerves on the pitch early on, with both sides desperate to avoid errors, and that caused the play to be disjointed. But all that changed on the half-hour. Now, this doesn't look the most obvious position for a shot on goal, even if the free kick is direct. Mel Stirling, though, had other ideas. But pity poor Simon Tracy in the Sheffield goal. Should he have held it? Blades boss Bassett certainly thinks so.
Well, I mean, obviously you've got to blame your keeper to some extent from that distance, but having said that, Mel's hit a tremendous shot, it's got a swerve, and if it had been a Brazilian, everybody would have been jumping up and down. A tremendous goal from Leeds' point of view, and obviously we just got to learn that Simon's got to stop one or two of those.
The trials of Tracy were soon forgotten, though, as Sheffield United, as they've done so often this season, hit straight back. Brian Deane pouncing on Batty's loose ball, Carl Bradshaw laying on the pass for Wilf Rostron. His chance to show Sterling's not the only fullback who can hit a first-time shot. With the Leeds back line still squabbling over who took the blame for that one, the Blades pressed on again. Bryson drawing the attention wide on the left before his cross was well met by Bob Booker, and Tony Agana slid the ball in. A great way to celebrate a return to first-team football after a long injury layoff.
Well, it found its way out to the left, I think, the ball. Ian Bryson played a quite a high cross and it seemed to be in the air for a long time. Bob Booker nodded it across and I just managed to get a left foot to it and you know, steer it home.
As in the best derbies, Leeds came straight back, and with one question mark already hanging over him, Tracy seemed to be handing out another seasonal surprise. But even if the cop had their hearts in their mouths as he tried to wrap up shut, Tracy proved one thing he doesn't lack is determination. His nerves were jangled again at the start of the second half as Strachan tried to emulate Sterling's first half cracker. And it seemed to be all Leeds in those resuming minutes, the action here like a pinball machine. Fortunately, Tracy once again proved his worth. The visitors' pressure was finally rewarded, though, as skill and determination from Vinnie Jones set up Carl Schutt. That goal keeps Leeds on top of Division 2, and to add insult to the Blades' injury, Schutt, like Sterling, is an ex-Sheffield Wednesday player. Two all and everything to play for, but here enter the comedian. Vinnie Jones is normally cast as the villain, but he proved that every Christmas entertainment needs a little levity. Was this to be the first throw-in taken from the stand?
It was a bit tense, the game and everything, so I thought I'd lighten the game up a little bit and get a little smile on their face.
Both sides then had chances to wrap up the points. First, David Batty put Gordon Strachan clear. At the other end, Tony Agana came very close to making it far from Mervyn's day. In the end, though, the spoils were shared, a result which keeps both managers happy. ...has promised promotion in 3 years. Today, he won the acclaim of fans before his first match in charge. They don't come tougher than Leeds United, and they showed early on just why they're doing so well this season. Hendry's cross providing Ian Baird with a chance. And it seemed the visitors were in danger of swamping struggling Barnsley, Gordon Strachan's fine run nearly catching out Clive Baker. The Reds did their best to seal their own fate, Archdeacon robbed by Hendry, who cut inside for Carl Schutt. But no one was there to finish it off. Barnsley were also having problems down the right, Whitlow's fine cross finding Vinnie Jones. It took the home side 39 minutes for their first serious strike on the Leeds goal, but it was well worth waiting for. Futcher's free kick is headed on by David Curry into the path of Darren Foreman. Joy for the Reds, but where was United's defence? In the second half, Leeds threw everyone forward, and in the 69th minute, it looked as if their patience was going to be rewarded, Malcolm Shotton's header falling into the path of Vinnie Jones. But United's joy was short-lived, his goal ruled to be offside. But Leeds refused to give up, and they pressed forward again. Mel Stirling, the creator of so much down the right, setting up Ian Baird. But if Barnsley rode their luck, they also owe a debt of gratitude to goalkeeper Clive Baker for this fine stop coming up from Chris Fairclough's header. And with 10 minutes to go, Leeds should have at least grabbed a point, but Carl Schutt wasted this effort with others much better placed. So celebrations at the end for Mel Machin, and he'll be forever grateful to Darren Foreman for starting off his reign at Barnsley in spectacular style. Ian McBride, Calendar Sport at Oakwell.
A striker Leeds bought from Nottingham Forest in midweek for £400,000. It was a former Leeds man, Scott Sellers, who set up Blackburn's opener after 2 minutes. Nicky Reid's cross, and where did Simon Garner come from? Come to that, who was marking him? There was more trouble to come for Leeds. Mel Sterling's missed header, and it's Sellers again. And Garner again. Off the post. Leeds' best early effort came from John Hendry. But Blackburn, who'd done so well against Aston Villa in the Cup, were looking confident. Frank Stapleton here beating Batty and Hendry. And then in this tussle, Mel Sterling damages knee ligaments. And he was substituted by Jim Beglin. And Leeds, who hadn't won at Ewood Park for 24 years, were up against it. Blackburn did give them a little help, though. Substitute Beglin's long ball here. Davison wins the header. And it's David Mayle against his own bar. And Nicky Reid away. So Blackburn survived there, but they didn't 6 minutes into the second half. The ball won by Batty. Vinnie Jones takes it on. Batty again, and he sets up John Hendry on the right. And Gordon Strachan's volley into the net, off the knee by Lee Chapman, his first debut goal ever on his first game at Blackburn. And a quarter of an hour later, it's his header that sets up Gordon Strachan for Leeds second. And guess who leads the celebrations? Vinnie Jones. Leeds were ahead on merit, but in the last minute, the referee decides that Tony Finnegan is brought down by Mike Whitlow. And it's a first senior penalty kick for 19-year-old David May. Leeds survive. And Vinnie Jones rushes up to congratulate Mervyn Day, who says, understandably, it was nothing. Blackburn 1, Leeds 2.
Offside in the second division promotion race, Hendry brought down, Leeds 1 up through penalty king Strachan. Swindon level though before half-time. White's nod down at the far post. McLaughlin beats Mervyn Day to the loose ball. Just after the break, Swindon showed they really meant business. Steve Foley with the header, 2-1. Leeds' equaliser, a deflection into the box. Nothing lucky about Hendry's finish though. But it ended a day of woe in Wiltshire. Ross McLaren crashing home the winner.
Game in 1990, and no wonder if their marking here is anything to go by. Gordon Strachan's cross, and Lee Chapman wouldn't have had much more space in the desert. Leeds celebrated. Ipswich were as sick as, well, their scoreboard. Leeds, though, remembered only too well how the East Anglian club put them out of the FA Cup last month, and they suffered an Ipswich goal here, 3 minutes from half-time. Kiwomia exchanging passes with Walk, deflection off Strachan, and Mervyn Day cruelly beaten in his 700th first-team game. Number five, Brian Gale, joins the congratulations on his home debut, but the former Manchester City man was out-jumped by Chapman to restore Leeds' lead from Strachan's free kick a minute later. Ipswich's second equaliser was well worked, but Howard Wilkinson won't be too impressed that no one picked up John Walk, arriving late, playing as a striker for once, and very successfully too. Finally, how's this for quick thinking? Haddock's first free kick, Linegan fouls Chapman. And Vinnie Jones doesn't hang about. That's what's known as a quick free kick, and it almost broke the deadlock. Almost, but not quite. Ipswich 2, Leeds 2. Second goal, a minute from half-time. Jim Beglin giving the ball straight to Lewis. Penny's unmarked on the touchline. Gordon Strachan's header put his own defence in trouble. They appealed for handball. It came off Steen's chest. And Simpson applies the perfect finish. Leeds 2-0 down at half-time, and the obituaries for their promotion challenge already being written. They were premature. Just before the hour, Sterling sets up Chapman with all the time he needed. and look at the determination on the Leeds faces. The fans may have sensed something special was in the air, and it was. Glenn Snowden was another Leeds man starting his first game of the season. His cross. Substitute Henry plays it back in, and Varadi does what Howard Wilkinson bought him to do. Billy Jones is always on hand for the celebration. 2 minutes later, it was Jones' throw that caused turmoil, and Chris Fairclough find its first, second, third time lucky. Leeds 3-2 in front at 20-5, but there were still 15 minutes left because of yet another late kickoff. Time enough for Gary Speed to catch Foster in possession. He keeps his head well here, and Chapman keeps scoring. Now, Vinny here is late for the celebrations. He arrives with a quiet word of congratulation for Chapman, a firm message for Alexi Sale, and a cuddle for the referee. Leeds were enjoying themselves at the end of 45 minutes, which could prove the turning point in the title race. Foster clashes with Hendry in the last minute, and the referee gives a penalty. Now, Gordon Strachan, the penalty king at Elland Road, delegated Chapman to take it to try for his hat-trick. The Leeds bench tried to stop this, knowing goal difference could be vital. And as it turned out, they had a point. But Leeds had 3. Oxford 2, Leeds 4.
As Gordon Strachan sets up Mel Stirland, only to find Tony Norman blocking the way. The G-Force back up front for Sunderland was soon in the thick of it, but Gary Owers can't capitalise on the work by Gabbiadini and Gates and misses probably the best chance of the night. Then after 23 minutes, it's Strachan and Stirland again making the most of the set piece and opening the scoring as the Roker defence seem in dreamland. It was only a matter of time before the latest meeting between the old enemies was bound to boil over. David Batty gets Colin Pascoe round the neck, and that's the cue for a mass brawl. Amazingly, everyone stayed on the pitch, including the man they love to hate, Big Vinnie Jones. Dennis Smith's men, desperate to keep in the promotion race, fell away in the second half, and it was only excellent keeping by Norman that kept them in it. But not even Marco Golo could level the scores. He could only blast it wide with just a few minutes left on the clock. Sunderland fading fast from the promotion race.
Goal. Chapman just couldn't get there. Gary Speed kept at bay by the post. Then David Batty's follow-up just off the mark. The Wolves' goal turned out to be a disaster for Batty. The ball diverted to him off Peter Haddock's head. But it's the back pass that will give him nightmares. Andy Mutch intervenes and waltzes round Mervyn Day to say thanks very much for his 12th goal of the season. A day of few chances for Leeds, this Mel Stirland free kick, one of them saved by Kendall. And then when Speed crossed and Leeds managed to keep the momentum of the move going, Strachan's cross accurate, but perhaps Lee Chapman's header was too accurate. Kept out again by Kendall, and it ended. Wolves 1, Leeds 0. Holden's plastic has never suited them, and thoughts that Joe Royal's boys might be tired after their cup exploits were quickly dispelled. Mel Stirland had judged there to foul Mike Milligan. And despite Beglin's protests, the referee unmoved. Mervyn Day went the wrong way, and Rick Holden made it Holden 1, Leeds 0. And the Leeds goalkeeper was soon to be called upon again. A good move down the middle. And Frankie Bunn's shot saved by Day. Then after Beglin's clearance goes against another Oldham player, Redfern shoots, Day saves, Molden crosses, and he can do nothing about Holden's second goal. And 2-0 soon became 3-0. Barrett heading forward, Redfern again involved, and Frankie Bunn's first league goal for 6 months. Leeds dead and buried already by the time that Strachan and Beglin contrived to set up a Bobby Davison header. A very well taken goal, his first for almost as long as Bunn's. Final score though, Oldham 3, Leeds 1. Fairclough, Chapman, Varadi all at the near post. It's come to a Brighton head, and that's a goal for Gary Speed.
and it's taken Leeds less than 10 minutes to go in front here at Brighton. Beglin down, it could be awkward here. Bremner tries to turn, tries to set up his man, and Brighton have got their equaliser. Strachan, and Leeds are picking it up a little. Chapman through, shut. Not quite a clear run on goal. Strachan is round the keeper. Can Strachan finish it? Oh, he's turned it across the face of the goal. An own goal, would you believe it? Drama here at the Goldstein ground. Wilkins delivers another one, and it's aimed towards the same vacant area. And it's a goal. Brighton have equalised, and it's crumpling.
So Howard Wilkinson sticks with the side which beat Leicester City 2-1 last Saturday. All eyes will again be on their influential captain, Gordon Strachan. And the only change is at substitute, where Carl Schutt has got the nod in preference to Imre Varadi. So Bobby Davison's come through, a fitness check okay, Leeds are unchanged. Bournemouth have had injury problems all season, and rumour has it that five of their lineup today are actually nursing injuries. But the good news for them is that their central defender Kevin Bond, the former Manchester City, Norwich and Southampton player, is back after a facial and an ankle injury, and the team captain takes his place instead of Denny Mundy. George Lawrence is in the attack instead of the on loan Richard Cadet from Brentford. Referee Roger Gifford is at Dean Court for the second time this season, having refereed the Zenith Cup tie against Chelsea in November. He was also here when Bournemouth beat West Brom. So a marvellous atmosphere at Dean Court as the curtain comes down on the season, with Leeds United bidding to take their place back in Division One after 8 years away. And the nerves are a-jangling here, I can tell you that. On both sides, Bournemouth, of course, it's just as imperative for them to win. They need the points to stay up, just as Leeds need them to go up. And away we go, with Bournemouth attacking the south end, and Leeds United are attacking the Brighton beach end. Yes, that's what it's known as here. And here is Gary Speed, and a good turn as well. That was inside Sean O'Driscoll, and Speed continues, and the ball is called for out on the far side by Vinnie Jones inside the penalty area. Had to lay it back for Speed, and Lawrence wins the first tussle with him. And it was Vinnie Jones who conceded the free kick. Flag it up. It was against Bobby Davison, who's playing wide on the right at the moment. It looks as though Peter Haddock is going to take Luther Blissett, and Chris Fairclough will concentrate on Trevor Aylott, who gets the flick on. Danger here for Leeds. Kamara gets it back. Nearly a disastrous back pass. The ball went straight to Blissett. The flag, as it happened, had gone up. So, a scare for Leeds here. That ball played, and Aylott flicking it on, but when Kamara passed it back, it went straight to Blissett, who was offside. So, no goals in the opening minutes. And another offside. The Leeds offside, Webb, working effectively. And Leeds are already having to take off Bobby Davison. Now that is a blow for them. Bobby Davison has just not been right at all in these recent weeks, and that is a blow for Leeds in these opening 10 minutes. They've been hoping for big things from Bobby Davison, but he's had a knee injury, and he must be very, very upset to have started the game and got no further than this. So Leeds bring on another striker in Carl Schutt. Good ball from Schutt to Strachan. Dainty play by the Scot. who keeps the move flowing with speed. Leeds have three men up around the far side of the penalty area as Begling comes in support. Here's Lee Chapman, back here, it must be all. Oh, what a save by Clayton. Goal shut from no more than 3 or 4 yards out, and a glorious chance to bury that one. And the Irish goalkeeper denies him with his feet. Lovely header back from Chapman. Shut seemed a certain scorer. It wasn't to be. And those are the sort of chances that must be taken. But Chapman again showing his power in the air. Strachan. It's longer this time, and a catch by Jerry Clayton, who's proving a very popular figure and a barrier to Leeds in these opening minutes. Kevin Boland has been out for a good few weeks with a facial injury initially, then a shin injury as well. They're glad to have him back. Well, Fairclough has done a good marking job on Aylott so far. Aylott's a good 3 inches taller. Begling with time now. Time to build it up. Kamara on his right. Strachan also out there. He feeds Strachan. Two men on the edge of the area. Strachan has to lay it back for Stirland. And here's another good-looking cross. Speed coming in at the back post. We'll still try and get that one in. Close again, this time for Kamara. Well, it's mostly Leeds at the moment, but the ball won't go in. Speeds cross that time, and Kamara couldn't force it through. And this is a free kick to Bournemouth in a rather dangerous position. And those are not the places to concede free kicks. And Bournemouth's Harry Redknapp will have been working on things like this all week. To remind you, in case you didn't know, the game is as important to Bournemouth as it is to Leeds. They want to stay in the second division. They have to win today to be sure of that, though they could be rescued, of course, by Newcastle beating Middlesbrough. Not many people in Leeds want that to happen. And there it's floated in, and a clear header. Well, it would have been for Aylott. They just did enough to squash him out, really. That was a scare. And now Leeds try to make it at the other end. And Kevin Bond pushes Gary Speed out of the way. And Roger Gifford, the referee, comes under some pressure from Strachan and Jones and Kamara for him to take action against Kevin Bond. And Bond will be booked for that. Speed had nodded the ball over the top of him. And the central defender, who perhaps can't turn as quickly as he used to do, push Speed out of the way, and he's booked. Strachan. It's coming out to Stirling. Well, he hit one in last week. Oh, and it nearly came through to Shut. It's a goal kick. Leeds wanted a corner. Well, Mel Stirling fired in an absolute cracker against Leicester 7 days ago. That's what Leeds are looking for today. Straight over the top of the defender, hooked on by Shett to Strachan. Leeds have three men up already, and Jones arriving. Stirland couldn't get it over the top of Coleman, but it will be a Leeds throw. Watch out for Vinnie Jones. Or indeed Stirland, well, he can take long throws as well, but this time it's just short to Strachan. That's too long. Won't actually go out. This time it will be left for Jones. Leeds still looking for the breakthrough. Here's Beglin, an intelligent run, smacked it across the middle, laid back for Chris Kamara. It took a deflection and still ended up in Payton's hands. Well, it could have gone either way. And it's just not running for Leeds at the moment. Laid back for Kamara, it came away from the defender and straight into Payton's hands. Jones hooks on. Strachan will chase and try to get in behind Coleman. Kamara out to shut, first time, and he didn't really need to do that. Oh, Jerry Payton stretching. Carl Schutt really panicked a little, I think, in that situation. He had time to play a better ball. Haddock forward, and again it's Schutt, and Bonnell lets him to relax for a moment, and Schutt nearly got in behind him. Well, Carl Schutt scored a goal at Middlesbrough this season where he got in behind a defender. Kevin Bond didn't seem to anticipate here, and Schutt took him on and only just failed to get there. Miller, and this time they've beaten the offside, and Bournemouth have three men ahead of the Leeds defence. Haddock comes across, concedes a corner, but doesn't mind doing that. He got back very quickly. Fortunately for Leeds, the ball bounced very high indeed. It took a long time in coming down. Otherwise, the offside trap would have let them down. They could have been in dire straits there, but for Haddock's speed. O'Driscoll wants the ball short. It's come across instead. And out by speed. O'Driscoll back in. Shearer. Good effort from Shearer. So close. Peter Shearer, former Birmingham City man who scored in the last home game here against Wolverhampton Wanderers, was not far away. Kamara, speed. I'd like to see him come more into the game. Leeds certainly would. Was there a free kick? Yes, referee Gifford says speed was fouled. But Gary Speed in the first few minutes of this game won a few free kicks for Leeds, and when he gets going, he's a dangerous customer because he makes straight tracks for goal, and they had to bring him down there. So what can Strachan conjure up? Or Stirling, maybe? Strachan with subtlety, Stirling with sheer power. Jerry Payton will know all about the ferocity of Stirling's shooting. Can he see a way through? He thinks he can, he smacks it in, and Payton collects it comfortably. Chapman will keep chasing all afternoon. Might try and get a corner out of O'Driscoll here. He's got the ball back for speed, in fact. He sensed that Brooks was coming in behind him. Floats the cross to the far side, and to shut, here's Strachan. Oh, Strachan bowled over. And the referee says no penalty. Kamara wins it back and fires in a shot. No strength in it. Strachan was hurt in that incident, without question. And when he picks himself up, he won't believe that he hasn't got a penalty for Leeds. But he hasn't. Referee Gifford took the opinion that the Bournemouth defender had done so fairly and squarely. And we approach half-time. Indeed, the referee just has a look at his watch. And that is it here at Dean Court. So, still everything to be played for in these final 45 minutes. And in this season where nothing seems to be decisive, it's going to go all the way. Sun continuing to stream down as we enter the last 45 minutes of the league season here at Dean Court. And Jim Beglin in the yellow shirt of Leeds drilling the ball forward and finding Carl Schutt inside the penalty area. Although Bond got up ahead of him. And Bournemouth's throw. Again, it's Fairclough in first. Spread out wide to O'Driscoll. Aylott's in an offside position. If the ball comes, it didn't come, but no offside flag for the moment. There is now against Luther Blissett. Plissett, who missed a penalty recently against Leicester, so if Bournemouth get one, his nerves will be going a bit. I don't think anybody else will volunteer to take one today. Forward from Day to Chapman. Came off his knee to Vinnie Jones. Speed turns his man beautifully, and the cross is here. It was too far for Chapman. Kamara, they've got to get a better finish of Leeds in this half. Beglin tries to put it across. Oh, it's off the inside of the upright. Would you believe it? And Bournemouth escape again. Kevin Bond against the inside of his own upright, and he must have thought that was an own goal, but it wasn't to be. And so far, things are just not going Leeds' way. The ball will not go in for them. Carl Schutt had a shot kept out from 2 yards by Payton, and now Bond off the inside of his own upright, and it stays 0-0. Well, that really was uncanny. And Leeds are suddenly going to have to work for all their luck today. It's not being put on a plate for them. Sterland up towards Chapman. Chapman down towards Schutt. Now the header on was by Shearer, but Chris Fairclough has stayed up there. Kamara trying to get a good cross in, and does so as well. Chapman! Lee Chapman for Leeds! A bullet of a header when Leeds needed it most. Chapman, £400,000 from Nottingham Forest, is paying off. And it's a glorious cross from Kamara which opens the door, and Lee Chapman thumps it past Payton into the net, and Leeds have the lead. And that coming after Bond's escape off the inside of his own upright, because it had made you feel as though it wasn't going to be Leeds' day. But now Chapman with goal number 21 of this productive season has given Leeds just the incentive. Here again, Chapman, and this could it, this could finish it. Lee Chapman for his second, it stayed out, and they can't finish it off. And it's to be hoped now that Bournemouth don't equalise. What a great chance that was for Lee Chapman. He's got one, but it would have been so much better if he'd got the second. And it would have looked so much more convincing at 2-0 as well. The one he scored might just be enough for the second division championship. It was a great ball through, and Lee Chapman had a lot of time to think about it, a lot of time to place the shot. Credit Jerry Payton, though. They're appealing to the referee to blow the whistle. These fans will stay for a long time in Bournemouth. I think they'll probably spend the whole weekend here if Leeds win. Probably next week as well. The back pass cut off. The referee still will not blow that whistle. Leeds want to bring on David Batty, but Strachan has the possession, and he's experienced enough to hold on to it. Does so well, rides every challenge and sets off those twinkling little feet of his. Gets it back, Schutt to Jones. Out to Kamara, and they're just playing possession football now. That's all they need to do. And the Olays are springing up around the ground, but in the end the ball is put out, and Leeds are going to bring on David Batty. Well, that's just to halt the celebrations for a little longer, just to slow things down. And Carl Schutt, who's done a manful job as substitute, goes off, and David Batty comes on to hopefully be part of the triumphant celebrations for a matter of seconds. And he wins the ball straight away, and Batty comes at Bournemouth, has to delay and hold things up, and then he's knocked off the ball. Well, we've had plenty of injury time. No final whistle, Aylott wins it. More unnerving moments for Leeds. That was just played straight against Jones's hand. There it must be offside, and they are. and that is it. Leeds United are back in the first division after 8 years, and the fans are all on to celebrate. The players submerged in a deluge of ecstatic supporters. Thousands have travelled to the south coast for this moment, and it's a moment that seems to have been building for weeks and weeks and weeks. And Leeds have no doubt deserved to be the champions of the second division this season. Their consistency in the end pays off, despite the trepidation and a few trembling footsteps over the last few weeks. So it's joy in the sunshine down on the south coast. One feels for Bournemouth, however, who are relegated at the same time. But all the joy is on the faces of the Leeds fans. Their players are submerged. They're all in there somewhere. But a single goal by Lee Chapman quickly into the second half has been enough.
Division 1, Leeds and Sheffield United are there already.
The banner outside the Civic Hall said it all, really. But this wasn't a day to dwell on that. It was an occasion for the true fans. About 5,000 supporters turned up to enjoy the occasion and put soccer to rest for a month or so, until the World Cup, perhaps. The Leeds United players will be off on holiday themselves soon, and most of them can't wait to relax. For these patients in hospital, they've no choice. And for Gordon Strachan, a special cheer. He's been the inspiration behind United's success this year, and much will depend on him in Division 1 next season. Not to mention the behaviour of the Leeds United fans as well.